two things. One, Syria first, and Jonathan, because you have to leave, I'll give you a chance first. This sense of where the administration is on Syria, and what is it that the president essentially said, well, look, we're going to look at more evidence. We may need to include more options. We want to hear from not only, we want to hear not only from our own investigators, but also what other governments are saying. What is the president waiting for in order to be able to respond to some of the criticism that's coming from the Congress and elsewhere?
Well, he's in a box. First, in terms of what they're waiting for in terms of the evidence, they believe that the intelligence is rock solid, that chemical weapons were used in Syria. And you heard it from today, the thing that they don't know is how it was done and who it was done. Yeah. They don't even rule out the possibility that it could have been the opposition using it in a way to try to get us to get into that war. But then the bigger question is, once you establish that, is what do you do about it? And I think you heard from the president, somebody who is absolutely has no appetite for a military venture in the Middle East right now. Even as well justified as it might be in Syria, there is no appetite for it, and there's real concern that whatever happens after Assad could well be worse than what we have right now. There's real concern about exactly who is in that opposition in Syria, and who will kind of fill the vacuum once Assad is gone. So that there's no good option here. And I think that they got themselves into a little bit of a box, Charlie, when they came out, when the president came out so strongly, first in Israel, saying that chemical weapons would be a game changer, that it would be a red line, yeah. Because then it raises the obvious question, okay, now what? Yeah. And they really don't have an answer for that yet.
Al, could his hand be forced on Syria?
Yeah, it can be, but I agree with Jonathan. The options are really horrendous and even worse than that. Because I think most people I talk to about that think the likelihood of after Assad would be a radical jihadist regime. We've seen the consequences of that in Afghanistan and elsewhere. And it's equally true that having drawn a red line, having said it's a game changer, and I think it's clear that whatever games are being played, that this is the type of brutal regime that certainly is and perfectly capable of using chemical weapons, and then you don't do anything, it does send a signal to North Korea and Iran and other places. So it really is just a series of terrible options for the president, some of his own creation, but some of it is just an impossible situation for anybody.
Chuck, Benghazi doesn't seem to go away. There was a story, and the president seemed to say, I don't know of that, but where is that point?
Well, I think the White House continues to believe Benghazi is simply just a political talking point for conservatives. They don't take this criticism very seriously, and they believe that the more evidence that you come up with, the more that backs up their version of events, that there isn't some sort of hidden aspect to this, that there isn't a cover-up, that what you see is what you get, which was this was a terror attack. Somewhat planned, somewhat spontaneous. It's murky in the middle. But the interesting thing about the Benghazi situation is that it does provide, frankly, a little bit of a caution flag, if you will, for the administration as it tries to deal with Syria. You know, we got involved in Libya. We came and decided that that was going to be, something that was necessary to do. We had the United Nations behind us. We had the Arab League behind us. So there was plenty of diplomatic cover to do that. But now that Libya is sort of trying to get itself together, you see that it's struggling. There are pockets of the opposition to Gaddafi that turned out not to be very friendly to the United States, something that we found out firsthand in Benghazi. And that's the real fear in Syria, which is why you have extra caution here. And I think you heard it in the president. Everything I hear about this, about, you know, he knows that he's got to follow through on his words, okay? Game changer and red line. He knows he's got to do that. But the follow through, Charlie, is not going to be U.S. fighters in the air creating some sort of no-fly zone at first. I think it's going to be something really small. We already know that there are reports about maybe just simply arming some members of the opposition that we identify as potential friendlies, or at least non-opponents, if you will. But it's going to be very careful while they try everything in their power to convince Putin that it's time to drop Assad, and so that a larger international coalition can come together. But what's post-Syria look like? Everything I hear is that it's not going to be one country. Yeah. That if Assad goes, this is not going to be one country. This is going to be partitioned or some sort of tribal civil war type battle for years to come.
And it represents the worst nightmare of some people that are hostile to the United States getting hold of weapons of mass destruction or chemical weapons. Right.